Welcome back, everybody. Today we're going to be doing section 6.6, which is all about the double angle formulas, the half angle formulas, and the power reducing identities. So we're just chugging along, learning more and more identities as we go. So let's get a few more. All right. So we're actually going to learn several important identities today. And some of these identities are ones that you are going to want to memorize. So I'll point that out explicitly when we get to it. But here's the overview. We'll derive the double angle formulas, then the power reducing identities. Then I'll have a list of six trigonometric identities that you need to memorize. So just want to emphasize these six, you absolutely do need to memorize. You must memorize them. And I'll emphasize it again when we get there. Then we'll get the half angle formulas, and that'll be it. So first, let's get the double angle formulas. And the theme for this section and the next section really is going to be leverage all of those other identities that you already derived. We don't need to make a geometric argument for any more of these formulas or any of these identities. We're just going to use the identities we already know, and we're going to basically massage them and tweak them a little bit until we get these new identities that can be helpful. So the first one is the double angle identity for sine. So if you look here, we can leverage the angle sum formula for sine to produce a double angle formula. All we're going to do is we're basically going to let the two different angles be equal to each other, and we're just going to relabel the angle theta. So sine of alpha plus beta just becomes sine of theta plus theta. And then all of the alphas and betas just become theta. But then look at what you've got. You end up with a double angle because theta plus theta is 2 theta. And then you end up with this result on the right-hand side, 2 times sine theta cos theta. And there you go. So that is the double angle formula for sine. Now let's do the double angle formula for cosine. The way we do it is very much the same. We're going to use the angle sum formula for cosine that we learned in the previous section. We're going to label alpha and beta the same. And then we're going to get that cosine of 2 theta is cosine squared theta minus sine squared of theta. Now, one of the things about this double angle formula for cosine is we can actually use the Pythagorean identity and tweak it into another helpful formula. So that's what's on the next slide here. So let me walk you through that. We're going to use Pythagorean identity. That's a typo right there. That should say cosine squared theta plus sine squared theta equals 1. So remember, that's the Pythagorean identity. That's definitely one that you want to have memorized, but we can use an alteration of that and plug that into our double angle formula that we just derived to get two other double angle formulas for cosine. So that's what we're going to do here. We're going to tweak this formula a little bit, and we're going to rewrite it as 1 minus sine squared theta, because that's what cosine squared theta is equal to, right? So we can do that substitution, but now we have an expression that just has sine squared theta in it. So we can re-express cosine of 2 theta as 1 minus 2 sine squared theta. And so this form can be helpful sometimes because it only involves sine squared. So it's kind of nice. Similarly, we could tweak the same formula, the Pythagorean identity, except this time solve it for sine squared theta. And then we can replace sine squared theta with 1 minus cosine squared theta. And when we do that, we get another double angle formula for cosine. All right, so we've got 1 for sine. We've got 3 for cosine. Now let's do tangent. Again, the theme is about the same. We're going to leverage the sum formula for the tangent function. We're going to call alpha and beta both the same angle right here. Here's the sum formula. Call them the same angle, and then lo and behold, we get this. The double angle formula for tangent. Okay, all together, here's the list. So these are all of the different double angle formulas. There's one for sine, there's a few for cosine, and there's one for tangent. You can use them whenever you need to use them. The nice thing about them is that it allows you to express a double angle in terms of single angles over here. So one common thing that my students will ask me is, hey, is sine of theta just equal to 2 sine of theta? So let me write this down right here. Is sine of 2 theta equal to 2 sine theta? And the answer is a big no, it's not. So just because the angle is doubled, that does not mean that the value of sine is doubled. And if you're unsure, you can always go back to the unit circle. Everything goes back to that same picture, the unit circle, over and over and over again. Think about what it would look like if you had an angle. Maybe I'll take this angle right here, right? Call this angle theta. And remember what the sine value is going to be. Sine is vertical displacement, so we're looking at this length right here. Well, if I double that angle, if I double that angle, am I going to get twice that length? I don't think so, right? What if I double the angle? I'll have something that looks a little bit like maybe this. And that's the sine value right there, the length of that line. And that's clearly not double the length of this line. So just because the angle is doubled, that does not mean that the horizontal or vertical displacement gets doubled too. So keep that in mind. So here's a bunch of these formulas. All right, now that we've got those, let's try an example and see how we could use them. Let's say if sine of theta was 3 over 5, where theta is between pi over 2 and pi, so it's in the second quadrant? Let's find the exact value of sine of 2 theta and cosine 2 theta. In essence, we're just going to write it in terms of just numbers without any trig functions. All right, so what I want you to do is think about this one on your own for a minute. And now try to say something out loud about how you would approach the problem. What would you use to find these formula, or what would you use to find these values? All right, and now try it on your own. See if you can use the formulas for sine and cosine, sine of 2 theta, cosine 2 theta, and see if you can find these numbers. All right, now let's do it together. So we're going to need a value of cosine if we're going to be able to use the double angle formulas, right? So one thing you'll notice is that the double angle formula for sine, and at least one of them for cosine, uses a value of sine or cosine. So if we want to be able to use the formulas, we're going to have to actually find the value of cosine theta on its own, this right here. But since we know that sine of theta is equal to 3 over 5, and we know that this value is also equal to x over r, where x is the... Actually, you know what? That should say y. My apologies. That should say y. Hold on. That should be a y. There we go. We know that sine of theta is y over r, where r is the radius of that circle. We know that the radius is 5, and so we can use the Pythagorean identity, or just the Pythagorean theorem, to find out what x is going to be. And in this case, we'll get that x is equal to plus or minus 4. So remember, x is the horizontal displacement, right? That's how I knew something was up here. X is the horizontal displacement. Now, whenever you take a square root, you must include a plus minus, and then you have to eliminate one of the cases if one of them doesn't make any sense. Now, we have additional information, right? We know that whatever the angle theta is, it lies in this quadrant. So if you're in the second quadrant, that means that cosine is going to be negative. So that's why we're going to choose the negative value of x. The negative value of x. And now that we know that, we have a value for cosine of theta. There we go. So cosine of theta is negative 4/5. Now we know what sine of theta is, we know what cosine of theta is, so we can compute sine of 2 theta and cosine of 2 theta. And here we go. Using the double angle formula, we get 2 sine theta cosine theta. Here's sine theta, here's cosine theta, which leaves us with negative 24 over 25. Then for cosine of 2 theta, we'll use this identity for it, the cosine squared minus sine squared one. Just square those results, take their difference, and you get 7/25. So we were able to compute those. One additional comment I'll make here, a lot of times we will actually omit the parentheses on an expression like this, sine of 2 theta. So sometimes we'll put parentheses around the argument of 2 theta, sometimes we won't. Either way is acceptable. The reason that we tend to omit them when it's just a simple product like that is because there's a lot of parentheses that get used, and we want to try to minimize how many parentheses we have to include. So if it's pretty clear from the symbol itself that 2 theta is just the angle, we'll often omit the parentheses. And if we want to emphasize what the argument of the sine function is, or any trig function, we will absolutely include parentheses. In particular, when we're dealing with angle sums. So let me flash back for just a minute here. Remember these angle sum formulas here, for example, you absolutely do need the parentheses, because writing something like sine of alpha plus beta is very easy to misinterpret. Very, very easy to misinterpret, because you're going to be like, well, wait, is that sine of alpha get that result and then add beta to it? Or are you saying take the sine of alpha plus beta? So you absolutely need parentheses when there are sums or differences involved. But when there's a product, a lot of times, When it's a product, a lot of times it's easy to infer what's going on. So in this case, 2 theta is the argument, so we just omitted the parentheses. All right, how about this? This is another fun thing you can do. Now that we have the double angle formulas, you can actually come up with a formula for something like sine of 3 theta, or sine of 4 theta, or 5 theta, or n theta. You can actually come up with a formula for sine of any integer multiple of an angle. If you want to think about that, you can, but let's start small. Try to do this one. Think about it on your own for a minute. How would you find a formula for sine of 3 theta using the double angle formula for sine? All right, now try to say something out loud to yourself or to whoever you would like, right? Maybe your group members, maybe your dog, your cat. What would you use verbally? How would you use it? All right, now try to calculate it on your own. See if you can use the double angle formula for sine to find a formula for sine of 3 theta. All right, now let's try it on our own. The catch here, or the trick I should say, is that you can write 3 theta as sine of 2 theta plus theta. But then we have an angle sum, right? So we can use the angle sum formula for sine and get sine of 2 theta cosine theta plus cosine 2 theta sine theta. So now we're actually going to need more than just the double angle formula for sine. We're also going to need the one for cosine, and we need the angle sum formulas. So sine of 2 theta, let me emphasize this, sine of 2 theta becomes this, and cosine of 2 theta becomes this. Now we can essentially distribute those factors, we can combine like terms, and we get this. And so that is a formula for sine of 3 theta. And you can always compute these types of things. So if you're interested, I encourage you to try to do the same thing for sine of 4 theta, and then sine of 5 theta, and see if you can find a pattern, because you should be able to find a pattern for it. All right, so that's it for double angles. Now let's talk about some power reducing identities. Here we go. There should be a little O in there. Power reducing identities. These ones are actually really important. So these ones are going to be part of the set that you do need to memorize. How are we going to do it? We're going to leverage the double angle formulas to get these power reducing identities. So here's how we do it. We're going to use this version of the double angle formula for cosine. And then we're just going to solve it for sine squared. So we're going to subtract 1 from both sides, divide by negative 2, and then we're going to get this right here. Where'd it go? Oh, yeah, there we go. All right. So what is this? This says that sine squared theta is equal to 1 half 1 minus cosine of 2 theta. And the power of this power reducing identity is that you can take something that has a higher power of sine and reduce it to something that has a trigonometric function in it, but no powers that are greater than 1. And that turns out to be extraordinarily helpful when you get to calc 1 and calc 2. Without going into too much detail, the short answer, or the short reason for that, is that trying to integrate something like sine squared is actually quite difficult to do. But trying to integrate something like this is quite simple to do. So this is one of the reasons this is one of the identities that you do need to memorize. and I'll have it on the list in just a couple minutes. Now, we've got one for sine. This is the power reducing identity for sine. Here's the power reducing identity for cosine. All we had to do was use the other double angle formula for cosine, and then solve for cosine squared, and we get this. One of the things that I like about these formulas is they're really easy to remember if you remember just one of them. So look at this one. This is cosine squared theta, and you get 1 half times 1 plus cosine 2 theta. But for sine, it's the same terms, but now the sine is opposite. Now it's a negative instead of a positive. See it? So that's nice. If you remember one, you get the other one for free. Now, for a tangent, maybe you could imagine what we're going to do. We're just going to rewrite tangent squared in terms of sines and cosines and use the power reducing identities that we just derived. So we'll rewrite tangent squared in terms of sines and cosines. We have a power reducing identity for both of these. Here they are. The 1/2s will cancel. And so we're just left with 1 minus cosine 2 theta over 1 plus cosine 2 theta. There you go. All together, we've got this. So here are all three of the power reducing identities. One's for sine, cosine, and tangent. And now let's talk about the list of identities that you need to memorize. So this list of 6 trigonometric identities is the list that you must absolutely memorize. Hopefully you've already got 2 of them memorized already, but you will need all of these identities in your back pocket at all times for when you get to Calc 1 and Calc 2. You want to be able to pull these out immediately. You want to be able to recognize these structures immediately. The other ones, not so much. Like the angle sum formulas, like I mentioned, they're helpful when you're trying to prove things, but you can always look them up when you're in that situation. They're not so much ones that you would need to memorize. The same thing as for the half angle formulas that we're about to derive. You don't often need those as much as you might think. And in my experience, the situations where you do need them, you can just look them up. But these 6 in particular, you absolutely need at the tip of your fingers at all times. So the first one is a familiar one, hopefully. The Pythagorean identity just comes from the Pythagorean theorem. Here is one of those tanning identities, as I like to call them. I tan in a second. If you want to remember the other one, sometimes that can be helpful too. I feel like it's easy to remember the other one, I cotan in a cosecant, if you remember the first one, I tan in a second. So you get another one for free. Third one here, the double angle formula for sine. You absolutely do need to know this one. And the reason, again, is kind of similar to what I mentioned earlier. It's really, really hard to integrate something that looks like this, where you've got sine times cosine. Generally speaking, it can be difficult to integrate a product. So it's nice if you can convert that product into something where there's only a single trig function, but the argument is just some multiple of the angle. That's actually quite nice to integrate. So this one you do need to memorize. All right, next one, the double angle formula for cosine, in particular this one, cosine squared minus sine squared. You need to have this one memorized because, again, a lot of times you will come across a structure that looks like this, and it's much, much easier to think of it as cosine 2 theta than this combination of cosine squared and sine squared. I have another note over here. The other double angle formulas for cosine can be helpful, and sometimes you'll see them, but not as much as you might think. And remember, if you forget what they are, remember how we got the other formulas. We basically just took this formula right here. We took this one and just plugged in the Pythagorean identity for it. Solve for sine squared, and you can rewrite the double angle formula for cosine. Solve for cosine squared, and you can write the double angle formula for cosine. So there you go. Then there's these two. So last but not least, the power reducing identities. The power reducing identities for sine and cosine, you absolutely need to have memorized. You'll use them a lot. Actually, we're going to use them in an example right now that is identical to one that you'll see in Calc 1 or Calc 2. So let's do it. Here we go. Write cosine to the fourth of theta in a form that does not involve any powers of sine or cosine that are greater than one. So I'll jump straight to the thinker and the speaker emoji here. So think about how you would do this using the power reducing identities, and then just say something out loud to yourself about how you would use it. All right, now try to work it out. The algebra might get a little bit hairy, so I recommend writing things in a neat, orderly, clean way as a chain of true equalities, preferably. Try to do it on your own. All right, now let's try it together. So we're going to use the power reducing identity, and here's how we do it. The first step is we're going to rewrite cosine to the fourth as cosine squared squared. Now, because we have that factor of cosine squared, we can use the power reducing identity on it, and we'll get this right here. Now, at this stage, all we're really going to do is FOIL everything out, multiply everything, distribute everything, and we'll get this expression over here, right over here. Another thing I'll point out, notice that when you have 1/2 squared, you get 1/4. That's where that 1/4 comes from. All right, now for this piece right here, all I really did was just FOIL this piece out. And and then I'll draw attention to this blue region here. You can kind of see it on the video, but this 2 theta is in blue. And I'll explain why in just a minute. So notice here that in this new result, there's another term of cosine squared. So this one is actually cosine squared. And we were asked to get this down to a point where the trigonometric functions involved did not have any powers greater than one. So what are we going to do? We're going to use the power reducing identity again, just on this piece, cosine squared of 2 theta. And that's what this becomes right here, right over here. And the thing that I want to point out here is this. Let me get my pen here. Remember that the power reducing identity for cosine has cosine of 2 theta in it. But in this case, theta for us, what is our angle? Our angle is already 2 theta. So that's the angle that's going to appear in the identity. And that's why here we have 2 times 2 theta, because our original angle is 2 theta. So now we need to multiply that by 2 to use the power reducing identity. So now things are a little bit messier, but don't worry, things clean up a little bit. So this is a bit messy right here, but this just follows from foiling and using the power reducing identity again. Now we can distribute that 1/4 to all of the terms, and we'll get this. There we go. And now we can just combine like terms to get our final result. All right. Now, as funny as it looks, that final result that you see at the bottom is much easier to work with when you get into Calc 1 or Calc 2. In fact, from that point on, the moment you learn about trigonometric integrals, which you do start in Calc 1 and then you revisit in Calc 2, this is exactly the calculation you will do. So if you want to think of it like this, this is what trigonometry looks like. This is what Calc 1 is going to look like. Integral d theta, and you're just going to have an integral sign around all of this stuff. And that's it. So this is what the calculation will look like. This is the calculation you need to perform when you get to those classes. And this is why you need to know the power reducing identities, because you'll just have to be able to pull them out right there and then and be like, oh, how do I deal with cosine to the fourth? Power reducing. Boom. And there it is. So be prepared. Memorize those identities. Take my word. All right, that's it for power reducing. Now let's move on to the half angle formulas. So these are formulas that will let us compute the sine, cosine, or tangent of half angles using the non-half angles, you could say. So how do we do it? We leverage the power reducing identities. So what we're going to do here is we're going to let theta be equal to alpha over 2. just to emphasize where the alpha over 2 is coming from, the half angle. And if we replace theta with alpha over 2 in those power reducing identities, we get these results here. Right, so remember, like for example, for sine, the power reducing identity for sine was 1 half 1 minus cosine of 2 theta, right? Well, if our angle theta is a half angle, alpha over 2, then those 2s are going to cancel and you get something that's even cleaner. You end up getting this right here. So this is the beginning of the half angle identity. We haven't quite gotten there yet. There's one more step. Just do the same thing for cosine, same thing for tangent, using the power reducing identities. Then we're going to take the square root of both sides in each case, and this is the list of formulas. So these are the half angle formulas. Remember, whenever you take a square root, you must include a plus minus. So that's something you definitely want to remember and take to heart. The way that I explain it to my students is, if you ever want to introduce a square root in your work, like you want to, if you're working with an equation and you want to take the square root of both sides, you must always include a plus minus. Always, always, always. Then you might get to eliminate one of those cases depending on the problem you're working on, but you must always include it in the beginning, plus minus. And in this case, we need these two results, the plus minus, and the way that we decide which one is going to be correct is by looking at the quadrant that your half angle lives in. So what quadrant does alpha over 2 live in? Depending on that, that'll determine if you need to choose the positive or the negative result. Because what's the sine value of that angle going to be in that quadrant? Well, if it's in quadrant 1, sine and cosine are both positive. If it's in quadrant 2, sine is positive, but cosine is negative. So maybe you'd need to take the negative result there, and so on and so on. So let's try an example. All right, so try this one on your own. So think about it for a minute. Find an algebraic expression for cosine 15 degrees and sine 15 degrees. Think about how you could set it up for just a minute. All right, now talk to yourself. Say something out loud about what you would do first. How would you try to set it up? All right, now try to work it out yourself. Use the half angle formulas and see if you can come up with an algebraic expression for these numbers. Okay, now let's do it together. Let's see, let's do cosine of 15 degrees first. And the first thing to notice is this. 15 degrees is in quadrant 1, so we're going to take the positive value for cosine because cosine is positive in that quadrant. And the catch here is we're going to rewrite 15 degrees as 30 degrees over 2. So what we're doing here is we're leveraging those standard angles that you were supposed to memorize, right? That's why you've got to have those memorized. You need to know all those standard angles, 30 degrees, 45 degrees, 60 degrees, 90 degrees, and so on. Because once you know those, you can use these identities to get algebraic versions of these values. So that's what we're going to do. This is the half angle formula, 1 plus cosine 30 degrees. But we know what cosine of 30 degrees is. That's a standard angle. Cosine 30 degrees, okay, it's going to be like that. Cosine is horizontal displacement, so it's the long leg. So it's going to be root 3 over 2. Then you can just do some massaging here, do some algebraic manipulation, and you get this as the final result. So remember, the book calls this an exact value. This is an exact value, but like I was saying before, so is this. This is also an exact value. What's nice about this value is that now it's expressed in terms of algebraic functions instead of trigonometric functions, so we can approach them in a different way. All right, now let's do the next part, sine of negative 15. Well, negative 15 degrees is in quadrant 4. We know that sine is negative in that quadrant. How do we know that? Remember, think about the unit circle. It always goes back to that unit circle. Here's Q4. Down here, vertical displacement is negative. So whatever the result is going to be for sine, it's got to be negative. So we're going to do the same trick as before. We're going to view 15 degrees as 30 degrees divided by 2 and use our half angle formula. Cosine of 30 we know. Cosine of 30 degrees is root 3 over 2. And then once again, we can do some algebraic massaging, get out all the kinks, and we get that as the final result. All right, next, there's actually another half angle formula for tangent that's more convenient because it doesn't involve a plus minus. So what do? You use a bunch of the identities that we've derived. We're gonna start with the power reducing identity and then we're gonna combine some things. But in the end, we will get a nice result for the half angle formula for tangent. So here's how we do it. Using the power reducing identity for sine, we're going to get that sine squared of alpha over 2 is equal to this. This is something we saw just a few minutes ago, but that's the power reducing identity. Now, if we rearrange things a little bit, you can rewrite it as 2 sine squared alpha over 2 is equal to 1 minus cosine alpha. This seems a bit arbitrary at first, but bear with it for just a minute. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to be a little bit clever, and we're going to look at sine of alpha. But we're going to rewrite alpha as 2 times alpha over 2. 2 times alpha over 2. So funny enough, once again, this is one of those most powerful techniques in mathematics. We're just multiplying by 1. But we're multiplying by a clever 1 in just the right way that lets us re-express this in terms of something else that we know. So check this out. Now that we've got sine of 2 times some angle, we can use the double angle formula for sine. And that's exactly what this is. That's the double angle formula for sine. Now, why did we do that? What's the point of that? Why does any of this matter? Well, we're going to finish up with a nice, clever result. We're going to do this right here. Let me clear the screen just a little bit. We're going to take this and divide it by this. So we're going to do 1 minus cosine alpha divided by sine alpha to get this. But now we have equivalent expressions for those. We know that 1 minus cosine alpha is equal to that. Maybe I'll do a little box here. There we go. And we know that sine of alpha is equal to this. So when you substitute those in, you get some really, really nice cancellations. Let me point them out right here. You'll get this cancellation. The 2's cancel, and then there's a sine squared of alpha over 2 up here. We can cancel one of them. There we go. Cancel one of those with that, and then look what you've got now. Sine of alpha over 2 over cosine of alpha over 2. Well, sine over cosine is tangent, so now we have a new formula for the half angle, or for tangent of a half angle. And the nice thing about this formula, again, it doesn't have a plus minus, so it doesn't matter what quad, you don't have to worry about the quadrants or anything. You can just literally plug in the angle for alpha and alpha, and then that'll give you the result. Now, other nice thing about this, there's another equivalent version of this formula, which we derive right here. So we can take the result we just got, and we can multiply it by 1. Use that technique again. Multiply it by 1 like so. But multiplying it by this value of 1 gives you a difference of squares in the numerator. 1 minus cosine alpha times 1 plus cosine alpha becomes 1 minus cosine squared alpha. Right? But what's 1 minus cosine squared alpha? Well, by the Pythagorean identity, that's just sine squared alpha. So now we can substitute that right there. And then kind of like we had seen in the last derivation, we're going to be able to cancel. We can cancel one of these with this, and we're left with sine alpha over 1 plus cosine alpha. And there it is. So now we actually have three different half-angle formulas for tangent. Here's two of them right here. And these ones are handy because they don't involve a plus minus. Don't involve a plus minus. All right. So that's actually it for all of the double angle formulas, the power reducing identities, and the half angle formulas. One thing I want to do before we call it a day here is just pop back onto this screen just to re-emphasize that you must memorize these six identities. You must have these memorized. Start committing them to memory now, and it'll save you a lot of headaches when you get to Calc 1 and Calc 2. Also, these are the ones that I will not be providing on the exam. So all the other ones, except for these six, will be given to you. But you need to know these six. Absolutely. Need to know these six trigonometric identities. All right? So on that note, let's play. Now you should go try to do the homework. If you've got questions, you can ask them on Canvas. And then the next section is actually our last section of identities, which is kind of nice. We'll get to move on to something different, right? The other nice thing about the next section is it's actually extremely short. The identities fall out very quickly, and the examples are really kind of cooked up. You'll see what I mean when we do it. But at least the next one will be a bit shorter, and we're almost through this part of the course, learning all these identities. All right. So with that, I'll say bye. Have a good day, everyone, and I'll see you next time.